Welcome this afternoon. I'm Abby Fennewald. I'm the events assistant here. And now I'm so pleased to welcome James Reston to discuss his book, An Accidental Victim. In a season full of Kennedy books, Reston finds a unique angle as his research shows that John Connally, not John F. Kennedy, was Lee Harvey Oswald's target on November 22, 1963. Reston has written 15 books as well as articles that have appeared in The New Yorker, Vanity Fair, and National Geographic, among many other news outlets. When President Kennedy was assassinated, Reston was serving as a research assistant to the Secretary of the Interior, Stuart Udall. We are so glad he is here with us today to share his Kennedy insights. Please join me in welcoming James Reston.
Good afternoon, everybody. So anniversaries are actually important. Or they can be important, but it's usually a factor of time, I think. Some anniversaries, if you look at the 10th anniversary of 9/11, for example, nothing really particularly happened of significance, and that event still, I think, has not been digested into the American psyche completely. If you look at the 25th anniversary of the JFK assassination, nothing really happened then except my cover story in Time magazine. But other than that, it nothing like the 50th anniversary here. When I was at Oxford as a student many decades ago, I majored in something called politics, philosophy, and economics. And in the Oxford thing, there was a principle that anything after 1850 was not history anymore, but politics. So there's something, I think, involved in that whole principle. Because in this particular case, the 50th anniversary, so much mythology and misinformation, I think, has grown up over the years about the assassination. And now, if you are aware of what's going on at the moment, there are books, there are TV specials, there is a Hollywood movie, there's glossy magazines of special editions, there's a huge amount of internet traffic. And it is as if, you know, John F. Kennedy is the greatest president that we ever had in our entire history. Certainly, I would say he is the most romantic, and he is the handsomest, and he had the most beautiful wife, certainly. Most stylish, perhaps. There was this Camelot syndrome. It's certainly true that he confronted the civil rights issue head on and is historically important for that. It's also true that he was immensely successful and effective in the Cuban Missile Crisis, where we were on the cusp of the possible slaughter of something like 40 to 90 million Americans had we had thermonuclear war. And then on top of that, of course, we have the tragedy of the assassination. And in effect, his martyrdom. So this is a story that is really kind of comports to the great themes of literature. But it's also, I think, a challenge with all of this that's going on to distinguish between the wheat and the chaff, between the true history and the politics, between the true history from the romance. So I wanted to tell you how this book came to be. In 1986, I was between books, and the publisher of then Harper & Row came to me and asked me if I would do a book about Jesse Helms, because I have deep North Carolina roots, having gone to school there and having taught there for 10 years. And so I took a big swallow, and I said, okay, I would do a book about Jesse Helms. And fortunately, I heard about 2 months later that there was another book on the way out on Jesse Helms, and I could call up my publisher and say, actually, this is not a figure that can bear two books in a short amount of time. And that was the old days of gentlemanly publishing. And the publisher said, "Fine, we'll just keep the contract in force and look for a replacement subject." And not long after that, John Connally had this enormously sensational bankruptcy sale, because having been the governor of Texas and the intimate of John LBJ, having been the secretary of the Navy, having been in the Dallas assassination car, having gone on to be a very effective secretary of the Treasury under Richard Nixon, changed parties, ran for the presidency, he decided he needed to go back to Texas and become Texas rich. And he had this catastrophic fall. So that seemed to me to be a very good subject, so I took the thing on. When I took it on, I was told, now if people are going to spend $25 on a biography of a major political figure, it needs to be 600 pages or more. So I worked for 4 years on this book and produced this, what they used to call a door stopper. And when I turned the manuscript in, the publisher said, you know, if people are going to spend $30 on a biography, it really needs to be only about 300 pages long. So that was a difficulty. Nevertheless, along the way in that telling that story, of course, I had to tarry in the Dallas assassination lore. And it is utterly fascinating. There's so many questions, so many levels of inquiry there, so many instances of misinformation that I really had a great difficulty in leaving it, because it was so interesting to me. And in the course of that, I got on to what I thought was quite an important new angle. And sometimes this is what happens with historians, that if you approach a great event from an oblique angle, sometimes some quite interesting surprises take place. And that's what happened to me in the John Connally biography with the Dallas assassination. I felt as if I got on to something hugely important that was very much against the received wisdom about that event. But I was commissioned to do the whole life, and so I had to sort of move on. And it was left this new insight to supposition, to suggestion, not to proof. It felt like unfinished business. So along came the History Channel about a year and a half ago to do an interview with me. And after I had done it, they told me that 85% of the American public believes that there is a conspiracy in the Kennedy assassination. This utterly horrified me, that figure should be so large. And why is it so? Of course, Americans love their conspiracies. But more important than that, I think the notion was that for so horrendous a crime as the killing of the American president, there had to be a grand and evil empire behind this terrible event. The Warren Commission that looked into this matter gave a very superficial explanation for Oswald's motive. He was a Marxist, and he had grandiose notions. He wanted to kill the president in order to decapitate the government of the United States, or he wanted a place in history. Now, this is what power figures of Washington can relate to, I think, this sort of intellectual, abstract thing having to do with power. But there are, of course, millions of Marxists, And not all of them are pathological killers. Many of us have grandiose notions, and that doesn't necessarily make us a pathological killer. So I never believed this explanation by the Warren Commission. It didn't make sense to me, not as a writer, not as a former novelist. And I think as important as that is that the insufficiency of the examination of the motive of Lee Harvey Oswald opened the door to all of these conspiracy theories. I felt that from my own experience as a GI, that there had to be something else going on here. Now, I was in the Army for 3 years. In Army intelligence at the height of the Vietnam War. I had been trained in the recruitment of agents to go into dangerous places. And in that enterprise, there were really basically three principles. That if you were going to try to get somebody to do something very dangerous, that was maybe life-threatening in order to get information for you, there had to be three things going on. One, there had to be access to the information. There had to be a deep motive for this person doing such a dangerous thing. And thirdly, they had to be reliable. So there had to be, when you get to motive, there has to be a strong internal emotional component to encourage somebody to do this. Now, as I said, I was 3 years in the Army as an enlisted man. Very proud of that. I was honorably discharged. And for me, as for most veterans, that was a profound experience. When you're young and have had that experience, it's sometimes and usually the most profound experience of one's life. And how one is discharged from a military experience is also hugely important. It certainly was so for me in 1968, but I think probably in 1959 it was even more important. And I think it's the insight of having had that military experience myself that became the entry point for me into the Oswald psychology. I had to imagine, what if I had done 3 years in the military and then had been discharged honorably, and after that, by some secret hearing, having to do with some sort of political activity that I had done after my military service, that discharge was summarily changed from honorable to dishonorable. I would have been furious. If you have to imagine further that discharge is the only important thing that I had ever done in my life, and that with limited education, I depended upon that for my employment, I would have been truly distraught. Now, I knew from my research that Russia had paid absolutely no real attention to Lee Harvey Oswald. He had been in Minsk for a year and a half, and after that year and a half period, he wanted to come home. Why? Because the Soviet Union had removed a special stipend that he was receiving as a kind of hero of the Soviet state when they sort of realized who they had in their kin. So that's really the reason that Oswald wanted to come home after a year and a half. I knew from my research that Cuba had completely ignored and dismissed him, and that there was really no credible or convincing evidence whatever that a criminal organization was involved with him. And then there's this wackiest theory of all, that somehow or another the FBI or the CIA was involved in the assassination. And I happened to run into somebody in Martha's Vineyard about a month ago who was on a panel with Richard Helms, who was the CIA director in those days in the 1960s, and he had made the remark, "We would never hire anybody like that," he said. So I think from my own intelligence training, from the research that I had done in all of this, it is absolutely inconceivable to me that any foreign government or any criminal organization would have relied on so irresponsible, so unreliable, so muddle-headed a character as Lee Harvey Oswald. If such an organization, criminal or international, was going to set out to kill the President of the United States, they would have hired a professional. And Lee Harvey Oswald was no professional. And so if we discard all of these wacky conspiracy theories, you know, it really comes down to that thing that I used to hear when I was younger, that if you hear hoofbeats, think horses, not zebras. So what we have here in The Accidental Victim is a historical argument that is profoundly anti-conspiracy. And I do believe that it would be an insult to the Kennedy legacy if this commemoration were to focus, if the conversation were to focus completely on these conspiracy theories, if the conversation was dominated by that. So what I'm seeking to do here with this, having gone back into that supposition from the Connally biography and tried to move it in my own mind from supposition to certainty, is to focus on the psychology and the mindset of Lee Harvey Oswald himself, to make this an examination of the psychology, not the politics of Oswald, because I don't think that the politics were involved in his motive. So here's the nutshell. Don't want to give you too much, of course, of the argument that Oswald was 3 years in the military, discharged honorably in 1959, and went immediately to Russia to attempt to defect. He does not technically defect, and that is an important point to remember. He's in Minsk for a year and a half. He marries Marina Oswald. She gets pregnant. They have a child. And Oswald decides, after his stipend is removed and he's no longer a hero of the Soviet Union, that maybe it's time to go back, that the Soviet Union's not really all that it was cracked up to be. And it is about this time, in January of 1962, that he hears that his discharge has summarily been changed from honorable to dishonorable. And he knows instinctively that this is a total disaster for him. If he has a ninth grade education and a flawed military discharge, who on earth is going to hire him? On the face of it, this was a true unfairness. There was no hearing. There was no notice to him. It was not based on his performance in the Marine Corps, but actually on activity later, political activity later. And so he tries to figure out who he should appeal to about this unfairness. And he decides to write to the Secretary of the Navy. The Navy Department, as you know, is over the U.S. Marine Corps. And so he finds out that the Secretary of the Navy is a Texan like himself, indeed a resident of Fort Worth, and he writes this heartfelt letter to the Secretary of the Navy, the critical line of which is at the end, "I ask you to look into this case and repair the damage done to me and to my family." 3 weeks later, he gets a reply, which is a classic bureaucratic brush off. "I'm no longer Secretary of the Navy. Here's my successor, sincerely yours. And it comes to Lee Harvey Oswald in Minsk. You can see the letter and the envelope in the book. In an envelope that says, John Connally for governor of Texas. And it has a big Texas star and John Connally's head in the middle of it. This is, in my view, the beginning of an obsession that Lee Harvey Oswald has with Connally. In effect, that face on the envelope of February 1962 gives a face to his frustrations as he returns home and tries to look for work. His period from when he returns home in June of 1962 up until he gets a final answer in July of 1963, the effort to change that unfairly changed discharge is really the through line of Oswald's life. It's the one constant strand. And it is because his Marine Corps service was the only significant thing that he had ever done. He knows instinctively that he's going to have trouble finding work, and indeed, that's what happens. And every time the question of his discharge comes up, he freezes. So it's that smiley face. It's that face of his frustrations that I think is very, very important to this motive, this internal driving force that moves one from complaint to hate and ultimately to violence. And his own wife, Marina, would testify to this obsession. She would testify to the Warren Commission, and she would testify to the House Committee on Assassinations in 1977 that Connally was the target on November the 22nd. Now, you have to put this next to Oswald's attitude towards President Kennedy, which is almost completely one of admiration. Jackie Kennedy was pregnant in the summer of 1963. Tragically, that child lived only 2 days. Marina Oswald was also pregnant with her second child during this period. They watched Oswald and his wife watched the progression of Jackie Kennedy's pregnancy. Oswald would have admired what Kennedy was doing in relation to the civil rights era. Of course, we had the I Have a Dream speech. We had the bombing that killed the girls in Birmingham. We had the March on Washington. All of that Oswald would have admired. There is nothing in the Warren Commission documents or any other places of which I'm aware that suggests that Lee Harvey Oswald had any animus whatever towards John F. Kennedy. Now, the final resolution of the discharge question comes on July 23rd, 1963, when he gets a final letter saying it is the decision of the Navy that no change, correction, or modification is warranted in your discharge. And so what we have here now at this point, I believe, is an obsession that is joined with a sense of being wronged. And any psychiatrist I would represent would say that is a very powerful combination altogether. Now, there are, beyond this question of Connally as the target, 7 accidents, I think, in the history of the Dallas assassination. The first emerges in March of 1963, when Oswald has become a very dangerous man and takes a shot at General Edwin Walker, who's a right-wing racist. Now, he doesn't hit Walker, comes very close to doing so. But what's significant is that the Dallas Police Department felt that this was a publicity stunt on the part of this right-wing guy, And they never really investigated it seriously or looked for the person who had fired that shot. That's the first accident, the failure to investigate the Edwin Walker shooting. The second accident comes in the march up to November the 22nd about the question of whether there would be a motorcade. John Connally was against it because there had been embarrassments and insults that had been done to Lyndon Johnson and his wife in 1960, to Adlai Stevenson, the then UN ambassador, only a few months before. So Connally thought that a motorcade was a very bad idea, but JFK overruled him, wanted to be close to the people. He was sentimental about that. The third accident comes in the question of where would this fundraising speech be held? And there was a debate that went on with great vigor between the White House and the governor's office in Texas. The Secret Service and the FBI wanted a place called the Women's Building, which is in the fairgrounds in Dallas. It's a venerable old pile. And they liked it for security reasons, including the route of the motorcade. Governor Connally wanted a place called the Trade Mart, which was a glossy new building that kind of reflected the business energy of Dallas. And more people could be put in there because this was partly a fundraising trip. So this debate went on, Women's Building versus the Trade Mart. And Connally wins that particular debate. It'll be the Trade Mart. What was important about that was if it had been the Women's Building, which the Secret Service wanted, then the motorcade would have come straight down Main Street of Dallas and gone straight through Dealey Plaza, not taking a right and a left. By going to the Trade Mart, it had to stop at a street called North Houston Street, slowly make a right, go one block to a street called M Street, slowly make a left underneath the Texas Book Depository, and then get on to the freeway that way. So that was the third accident. The fourth accident, it has to do with the bubble. You've heard a little bit about this from Jim Lehrer's novel, where it was raining in Fort Worth on the day of November the 22nd, and there was a debate about whether there should not be this plastic bubble put on the presidential car. This was a kind of a flimsy little thing that was actually kept in the trunk of the presidential limousine, and it was not bulletproof. But nevertheless, it was decided as the clouds lifted and it became a nice day in Dallas that they would not use the bubble. If they had used the bubble, even though it was not bulletproof, there's no question but what, if you think about the line of sight of the assassin from the sixth floor of the book depository, that through shadows of the tree or reflections from the sun, that this could have made it far more difficult to do a accurate shot. The fifth accident in this has to do with Oswald getting his employment at the book depository, which was only 5 weeks before the assassination itself. And the sixth accident is that the FBI knew he was in the book depository because he had been put on a list for two reasons. One, he was a subscriber to the communist journal called The Daily Worker. And the other reason was that he had made a trip to Mexico City and had a contact with the Soviet Union, the Soviet embassy in Mexico City. So they knew that he about Oswald. And indeed, an FBI agent by the name of Husty, James Husty, questioned Marina Oswald 1 month before November the 22nd. She told him where Oswald worked, he did nothing to investigate further. So this is yet another example of this cliche that we hear nowadays about connecting the dots. So if you put these accidents together, the failure to investigate Walker, Connally losing the argument about a motorcade, the trademark over the women's building, the no bulletproof bubble on the convertible, Oswald landing his job by accident in the book depository, the FBI knowing about his presence there but not following up. This is a sequence of tragic accidents. John L. Lewis, of all people, champion of organized labor, has the handle on all of this. He made the remark once that the doors of history swing on tiny hinges. Now, the seventh accident is the biggest one of them all. I got onto this with the Connally biography in an interview with then Senator Ralph Yarborough of Texas. You know that John F. Kennedy had a terrible back problem. It came from the PT-109 episode. You may not know as well that in 1955 he had two operations on his back, the first of which was botched and had to be repeated in that year. And he was in such distress that his doctor, Janet Travell, testified that he could scarcely walk up one or two steps to her office in 1955. He went to extraordinary lengths to cover up this this disability, putting phony names on hospital doors and making sure that the records were locked in hospital safes. Over the years, he tried many remedies, including self-medication, to relieve the pain of this. But in 1963, he had moved to relying on a back brace. Now, I've seen that back brace in the National Archives. It was something really out of Gone with the Wind. It has laces, and on top of the laces, when they're winched tight, there are three belts to further tighten the thing. It's really like a kind of scene out of Gone with the Wind, with, remember, Scarlett O'Hara hanging onto the bedpost while Mammy winches her in. This scene should have been in the movie The Butler, but it wasn't. At any rate, we can talk about this in question and answer if you want, but I believe that the back brace killed him. Now, I thought I would end with just read you the last page of Accidental Victim. On February 11th, 2013, I traveled to the National Archives in College Park, Maryland, taking with me Dr. Lawrence Altman, the longtime medical correspondent for the New York Times and my colleague at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. It had been a struggle to get the archives to agree to let me see the corset that the president was wearing on November the 22nd, 1963. One had to have a very good scholarly reason as to why looking at the picture of it was not enough. For appropriately, the archives was intent to resist the voyeurism that sometimes surrounds the Kennedy assassination. My reason was that I needed to see the actual brace to evaluate the stiffness of the plastic disc in the back of the brace that covered the president's sacrum and further bolted him upright in his seat on that day. Two archivists brought the artifact to the antiseptic viewing room in a pristine wooden box. Opening it carefully as if they felt the weight of history, and then putting on white gloves, they lifted the tan corset out and laid it on the table. I asked them to measure it and to put my wide palms over my own midsection to imagine how complete the grip of the thing was. And then they spread out the wide ace bandage that had been wrapped over the corset. If in developing my theory about the psychological importance of Oswald's military discharge, I was channeling my own military service and remembering how much I valued my own honorable discharge, now I was referencing my experience as a pretty good but often injured college athlete and the many times I had used an ace bandage to hold my bruised and battered body together. It was almost beyond imagining how tight that corset and ace bandage ensemble must have felt as the president went out in public. I wondered how he stood it. One of the archivists pulled out the plastic disc from its envelope in the back of the brace. I did not want to touch it. In past projects, I had felt the detritus of history. I had handled the transcript of Galileo's interrogation by the Inquisition. I had watched a North Carolina prison director snake the tubes of a lethal injection apparatus between his fingers as we talked about the female prisoner he was about to execute. I had walked the walls of Crusader castles when I was writing about the Third Crusade of Richard the Lionheart and Saladin, and waded through the tall grass around the pavilion at Jonestown, littered with toys and baby bottles. But there was something different about this damned girdle, as the late Senator Yarbrough had called it in our conversation 25 years ago. This is as close as I ever want to get to the quintessence of tragedy.
There's another author who just released a book, Jerome Corsi. He wrote Who Really Killed Kennedy, and he theorizes that it was the military and financial elites. How did he get it so wrong and you get it right?
Well,
Jim's a buddy of mine, so.
Thank you for that spin. You know, I would say to anybody who would argue something like that, prove it. What's the evidence? Show me the beef about who was behind Lee Harvey Oswald, who would have tried to hire this wretched character to do an act like a presidential assassination. That, you know, we can't know everything. This is a historical argument that I have made. It's not a scientific argument. So in historical arguments, you cannot prove it, but you can marshal the evidence as much as possible and then make your case. Again, I go back to my own personal experience in the military, that there has to be an immense amount of planning that would go into an operation whose goal was the assassination of a U.S. president. And there are so many accidents and so many happenstances in all of this that lead one to the conclusion, I believe, the compelling conclusion that spontaneity, not planning, is at the center of this. No police organization or military organization sets out to do something like this relying on spontaneity. It's just inconceivable. Yes, sir.
Hi, Jim. Yeah. You talked about the Warren Commission and the conclusion they came to, and I know you went through their records. What did you find in the Warren Commission records that supports your argument that Connally was the target?
Well, it's primarily who knew Oswald in Dallas in the period after he returned from the Soviet Union. And there were really only two significant sets of people or persons. The most important is Marina Oswald. Now, she is a timid woman, speaking very little English, if any at all, in 62 and 63. And she does not engage in political conversations with him. But she does, as his spouse, understand when he's going down dangerous paths. There are, people say, you know, why would he choose that date when the president was with Connally to try to kill Connally? Why wouldn't he have done it at some other other point? Well, there are two instances of stalking of Connally by Lee Harvey Oswald in the prior period, and these are testified to by Marina Oswald. One is that he goes to the governor's office in Austin and tries to see Connally. And this is much remembered by a woman that greeted him at the governor's office. More importantly is that he is at one point, he hears that he tells her Nixon is coming to town. And he gathers up his pistol and he's about to go off to kill Nixon. And she knows this is a hugely dangerous moment, and she locks him in a bathroom. And they argue for, it seems like, several hours as she attempts to bring him down from his frenzy, in a way. And it turns out Nixon was not coming to town at all. It was Connally who was coming to town. Marina Oswald is the first and most important witness, and she testifies because of this animus, because of this obsession that he had with Connally, together with the admiration that he had for Kennedy, that Connally was the target. So that's one. The other group of people, only a few actually, are the Russian emigres who lived in Dallas. And when they came back from the Soviet Union, they quite naturally fell into this circle of Russian emigres. And one in particular, a man by the name of George de Morenschild, has extensive testimony in which he talks about this obsession with Connally and at the same time admiration for Kennedy. So that's the evidence, and it's, I think, pretty clear and convincing in the Warren Commission documents.
You mentioned, you've actually answered most of my question. Connally is governor. How often does he come to Dallas in the previous year? Is it only twice, or is he there fairly often?
I don't know the answer to that. Where you may be going is, would Oswald have known about the governor's itinerary if he came frequently to Dallas? Is that where you're going?
Yeah, I mean, as a governor, it's a lot easier to kill a governor than it is to kill a president, especially from, you don't have to do high altitude shooting. They're frequently on street corners and public locations. But I would think that it would have been easier for him to have picked a different.
You know, it's the thing about doing a book like this that everybody tries to get in the mind of Oswald, including me, of course. You know, if you're Oswald, how do you find out what the governor's itinerary is? Governor's itineraries are not frequently published. But the other point is that this is a guy that had two nickels to rub together. You can't be running around the state of Texas after the governor of Texas if that's who he really is desperate to kill. because he doesn't have the funds. This is the accident of history, that it happens that this car is going to go right under his window. And so it seems to me it's not so important as to what happens in the line of sight of the assassin's rifle, but what was his emotion on the morning that he has found out that they're going to go right under his window. Why does he pick up that rifle? And, you know, does he pick it up because he wants to be a figure of history, or he's a Marxist and an ideological Marxist? I don't think so. Those are abstract intellectual ideas. There has to be hate, emotion, something deeply internal in that emotional makeup to contemplate that act.
Go ahead.
This isn't a question, it's a comment. Somebody once said about paranoia, when you have a choice between conspiracy and ineptitude, always choose ineptitude.
I can use that. Thank you very much.
Hi. It just seems amazing to me that both Marina and the other man that you mentioned testified to his obsession with Connally. Did they ever give it that much weight in the investigation? I would think that would be given great weight.
This is a critical question. This is a very, very profound, profound question. The back and forth testimony with Marina Oswald, where she says he's the one, is really rather brief. And it is an extraordinary piece of I think, stupidity, that she makes this extraordinary statement, and the congressman does not follow up on it. The interchanges go on for, I don't know, maybe three or four or five interchanges in this testimony, and he goes on to some other flyer of a question. Now, that happens when the Warren Commission report is already written, basically. And I think there are two points there. One would be, you know, were they going to completely reconfigure what they had written in the Warren Commission report? Marxist, place in history, you know, all of that. Were they going to go back and get much more deeply into the psychology of Oswald? The other point, you'll just have to take this for a Reston opinion, is that it would have been very politically difficult in 1964 for the report of the most extensive investigation in American history, for that report to say that the President of the United States was killed by accident. Very difficult to sell that to the American people. So it's left abstract, it's left vague, it's left rather grandiose in terms of ideology or the psychology of grandiosity or something, and it's just very transparent. But I'm a huge admirer of the Warren Commission for 99.9% of it, but that one failure, I think, opened the floodgates to the whole world of conspiracy theories.
Ineptitude versus conspiracy, yeah. I think you've made certainly a convincing case for the infatuation of Oswald with Connally, or the hatred. But what was his comparable infatuation or hatred for Walker, that he actually took a shot at him?
Yeah, well, I mean, it could be... stated by a rational person that the Walker event in the spring of 1963 was a political act. You have seen, well, you can actually see it on the back of my book, the famous picture of Lee Harvey Oswald taken in the garden of his home in Dallas. I went to that house about 3 weeks ago. He obviously was very proud of that picture. And he sends it at some point in this period to this friend of his, George de Morenshield. And on the back of it, it says, "Hunter of fascists, ha ha ha." So that would suggest that, you know, there was a political motive, you know, filtering into his psychology of frustration. But if you wanted to keep this on a political level, that would square with my theory of, you know, he would put Connally in the same boat with General Walker. But I'm not sure that was a political act. I'm not sure it wasn't an act of frustration, kind of acting as if he was, you know, a political player. But I just can't get that up front and center as the motive for that shooting or for November the 22nd as politics. Okay.
Hi. I wanted to make a comment. I'm very sensitive to the fact that coming from a linear background, you know, I graduated from college in 1968, and contrasting the quality of the journalism that you get from, say, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, Washington Post, with what you see in the 24-hour news cycles that we have in America, what strikes me about your unique discovery is that, and let's say that that the assassination was the most traumatic event in American history since the assassination of Lincoln, and 9/11, although that would be the third, is obviously quite different psychologically. There's something about the assassination of a president that I think has no equal. What I wanted to say was what I find interesting, the most interesting about everything that we're discussing here and thinking about here is, like I said, in the 24-hour news cycle that we now take as we inhale, like breathing in and out, there is no substitute for the lone writer working in isolation and solitude who doesn't have any kind of time constraints. The lone writer seeking out and finding the truth.
We are
overwhelmed with commentary and analysis and, as I say, unending news, breaking news, which is usually pretty
Well, I'm not
trivial.
A newsman, and this is not the only experience in my life of coming onto something out of the depths of historical research. If you saw the movie Frost Nixon, you know that I had another experience along those lines. It is the really the joy of being a writer of works that take years to accomplish, that you come upon something that is so startling and so new, mm-hmm. that it's just tremendously exciting. And that's what happened to me with these two theories. The second one I didn't really flesh out for you all, but I believe that the reason that the corset killed Kennedy was that he was held upright for five full seconds for the second killing shot in Dallas.
Hi, Jim. I have two quick questions, if you will, and this might relate to what you're just saying. Can you discuss the ballistics? If Kennedy was the first shot, but Connally was the victim, and I don't know the answer to this, were there more shots taken? Is there evidence that Oswald was not... You said he was an admirer of Kennedy, so he must have been distraught. He hit the wrong man, and did he continue to try to shoot? And what was Connally's position?
Right.
And the second question, I think you also adverted to, but I want you to expand on it, because I think it's really interesting, about the Warren Commission's failures. So this was at the height of the Cold War. You said delicately that it was would have been politically difficult to sell a different conclusion.
Right.
I mean, I could certainly imagine that in the height of the Cold War, the American public very much wanted to hear this killing was another aspect of the Soviet imperialism, and it supported our view that, you know, there was an evil empire, we needed to combat it. Is there evidence that there was that kind of fervor that we wanted the victim here? We wanted the perpetrator to be the Soviet Union through Oswald?
Yes, yes, yes. I think that's it. Well, as to the ballistics, it's really dramatic to go to Dealey Plaza when this is all in your head, because you get insights about the way this happened. There is underneath the window of the sixth floor, which was the sniper's nest, a big tree. And so as the car goes slowly, first, instead of going shooting through to the women's building, has to stop, turn right slowly, and go one block underneath the sniper's window, slowly turn left. Clearly, Oswald had decided that he was going to shoot as the car was going away. But it meant that he had to wait until the car cleared the tree, so that by the time the car is going down the sloping street of Elm Street, the bodies of the president and Governor Connally are almost aligned. So it is a false tack to say, well, if he was going after Connally, why didn't he just shoot Connally, or was he a terrible shot? In point of fact, that first bullet goes through the president's neck and into Connally's back. And what happens is that, I should preface it by saying, if you're onto the thing about it being a bad shot, he could very easily have killed both men with that first shot. It goes through the president's neck, missing his spinal cord by millimeters, and it goes through his neck and into Connally's back, and then through Connally's body, hitting his thigh, and then hitting his wrist, and then ending up in his thigh. That second thing misses Connally's heart also by millimeters. So had it been millimeter, just one little bit to the left or right, he could have killed both men with that one shot. So as I say, it's it doesn't undermine my argument that the first bullet hits the president as well as Connally. Now the critical thing about the corset is that Connally immediately, if you study the Zapruder film, which I have done many times, Connally immediately starts to writhe in terrible pain, of course. And he goes to the right, and he goes to the left, and then he is pulled down in his wife's lap. And there's 5 full seconds here as this takes place after the first shot, before the second shot. And when the second shot takes place 5 seconds later, Governor Connally is out of sight. He's in his wife's lap. And the only target that remains to him, to Oswald at that point, is the president, who is held upright, almost mummified, by this corset. That's why Oswald had a clear target as the car is going down the hill. So it's only 2 bullets that's important.
So why did he take the second shot?
Any hunter or any Marine, I would say, would tell you, if you have started shooting at somebody, you don't immediately say, a couple seconds later, you know, oops, the guy really after is in his wife's lap. I think I better stop. The psychiatrists tell you there is a principle in psychiatry called the motor program. If you have started something, it's very this horrendous, full of excitement and adrenaline, it's virtually impossible to stop. So it's, you know, shooting once, preoccupied with getting the second bullet, sighting again, and then what have you got? So a motor program is at work in all of that. Does that satisfy question number one? Question number two about selling the accidental victim notion to the American public in 1964. No question in the context of the Cold War that the comfortable conclusion of the American people would be that there had to be an evil empire behind this. You have the fact that he's a Marxist, so that, you know, that goes right to him, that he's had contact with the Soviet Union, he's had contact with Cubans, he's into street protests about fair play for Cuban. Of course, Cuba or the Soviet Union has to be behind that. So the Warren Commission doesn't argue that. It argues for the lone killer and doesn't present any evidence whatever that Cuba or Soviet Union is, but it's left there for people to pick up and assume, and that's what they've done. Okay. Thank you.